examinations. So do visit AKS IAS Academy and also the website of AKS IAS Academy. About me, I am Sandeep Bhushan Thummala, and my credentials are, I have 10 years of teaching experience for civil services. I teach international relations and internal security. I also take up the daily newspaper analysis of The Hindu. And this session will certainly help you to crack prelims and mains examination, because throughout my session, I would be emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases which we will be focusing from the news, that is daily news analysis. So these keywords and the key phrases are crucial for you to have an edge over others in the prelims as well as mains examinations. So in the prelims, through the identifying keywords and the key phrases, you can definitely get into the mode of identifying the factual, analytical and conceptual questions for the preliminary examination. And the keywords and the key phrases, once you start imbibing in your answer writing, so that definitely it will be useful for you, because once you imbibe, your answers would be precise and concise. And once your answers are precise and concise, so definitely you will score higher marks in the mains examinations. So thereby, the AKS IAS Academy daily news analysis will certainly help you to crack prelims and mains examinations, both for 2020 as well as 2021. And this session is in regards to the DNA or the daily news analysis, and it will be, the DNA would be of 26th September 2020. And as my tagline goes ahead with emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases. And the quote of the day is, wake up with a determination. So always have in your mind the determination for what you are actually started your path, and then let there be determination and go with bed with satisfaction. So have the determination and have the satisfaction early in the morning and well while you go to bed also. So wake up with determination, go to bed with satisfaction. And before I get into the daily news analysis of the newspaper, I would say a very good morning to everyone who is in the live and also in the live chat. Good morning to Kalyan Chakravarti, D. Suvarna, Praveen Kumar, Rahul, Charan, Chendu. A warm welcome to everyone to AKS IAS Academy daily news analysis. And now we'll focus at the news, which is, the Vodafone wins 2 billion tax case. It wins 2 billion tax case from whom? From the government of India. So it was a case, Vodafone versus government of India. It was Vodafone versus government of India. So Vodafone Group PLC has won an international arbitration case against the Indian government, and this was the most high profile dispute. It was a high profile dispute in regards to the government of India and the foreign investors investing in India, and this amounted for $2 billion tax claim. So government of India has claimed 2 billion from Vodafone Group PLC, but in turn Vodafone Group PLC has approached international arbitration case, or it has approached the international arbitration tribunal, and it has won the case against Indian governments, which the international arbitration tribunal is situated in Aig, and the IAT or international arbitration tribunal has ruled that India's imposition of tax liability. So India has imposed, or it has claimed Vodafone to pay $2 billion as a tax liability, that is in the form of the interest and penalties, in the form of the interest of penalties. So what the government, India has imposed a tax liability onto the Vodafone Group PLC. What the International Arbitration Tribunal has ruled out is that India going ahead with the decision of imposing the tax liability is in a breach of an investment treaty agreement. This is in a breach. That means breach in the sense against. Against. Against the investment treaty agreement between India and Netherlands. Between India and Netherlands. So this is the one which the International Arbitration Tribunal has ruled, saying that India has breached, it has gone against the investment treaty agreement between India and Netherlands. So thereby, now the Vodafone Group PLC has won the case, and in turn the International Arbitration Tribunal has directed the government of India, to pay $5.47 million to the Vodafone company as a compensation for its legal cost. So are you getting the point? As I said, the Vodafone has won. Here we said Vodafone Group PLC has won the case, tax liability case, which was put forth by the government of India onto the Vodafone company. And when the company has won, the tribunal has directed India to pay back. See, government of India has claimed $2 billion as a tax liability onto the Vodafone to pay as part of the interest and penalties. But when the case the government of India has lost and the Vodafone Group PLC has won, in turn the tribunal has directed India to pay back to the Vodafone company itself as a compensation, for all the legal cost the Vodafone company has incurred during the entire process. And the tribunal has also said the government's demand is in breach with fair and equitable treatment. So it is against the fair and equitable treatment as per the agreement between India and Netherlands. And India has claimed, as we said, that almost $2 billion in tax, as well as in the form of the interest and penalties against the Vodafone. But now, because of the case won by Vodafone, India is supposed to pay back to Vodafone company. And we have seen this kind of, what you say, government of India being entangled or being in the case with various other companies also, for example with Kane Energy also, wherein India was, government of India was asking or putting the claim onto the Kane Energy. This is another company, claim energy company, over retrospective tax claim. So again, on this company also, government of India has claimed the retrospective tax and cancellation of contracts to this company, wherein the government of India has raised this in the past also. So in the past, Kane Energy and now Vodafone also. And yesterday we have also seen Harley Davidson closing the manufacturing and the sales outlet from India, that is from Haryana, Gurgaon. We have seen that Harley Davidson, the US manufacturing, bike manufacturing, and in turn we have also discussed that Ford Motors also has pulled out in the past. General Motors, and then the Harley Davidson. Yesterday we discussed this. This is the global manufacturers. They have pulled out from India. We have discussed this. And today if you look at the Vodafone has won the case. And in the past, I mean, this Vodafone, government of India has blamed in regards to the tax liability claims. And again in the past also, Kane Energy also, again in regards to the tax claims. So look at it, the way the foreign investors, these are all foreign investors and these are the global manufacturers. So the foreign investors, definitely they will lose the confidence that they can come and invest in India because of the tax liability claims being made by the government of India onto various foreign investors. So this is the cause of concern, and it will have some kind of negative impact onto the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan scheme, self-reliant, I mean, wherein we wanted, at the same time, we wanted the FDIs to come into India. We definitely wanted Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan scheme to take up.
But along with that, we wanted FDIs to come and invest in India, because yesterday also I was talking about that the foreign investors who are moving out of China, India is attracting, trying to attract them and then make sure that we provide a platform for the foreign investors pulling out from China to come and invest in India. But if you look at these kind of situations or the tax liability claims wherein the foreign investors are winning over against the government of India is the cause of concern. Please you understand this analytical point of view that we have looked at yesterday's news. Also we have focused, we have linked yesterday's news with today's news, that is global manufacturers with foreign investors. Please do understand this. Entangle means like they are into the almost like mixing up, or they have been brought into a mode of having the kind of situation or relations which are not favoring both the countries. They are in the net, entangled, they are in the net, or they have some issues. Kalyan Chakravarti, entangled is issues. And Vodafone tax dispute stems. So we will look at from since when the Vodafone and the government of India, they have the tax dispute. So definitely you have the dispute resolution mechanism. If you look at now, I have taken up a topic called as Singapore Convention. Singapore Convention. So this Singapore Convention, now it will create a platform to all the foreign investors when they have any kind of dispute. That dispute resolution mechanism can be taken up through the Singapore Convention rather than approaching the International Court of Justice. It can be resolved. It can be resolved at this by the Singapore Convention, wherein rather than going there and then rather than having any kind of dispute mechanism. So link this Vodafone tax dispute with what we have discussed recently, a topic called as Singapore Convention, that is also in regards to the dispute resolution mechanism. So this dispute between India and or else government of India and the Vodafone has started in the year 2007, when Vodafone has gone ahead with 11 billion deal to buy the Indian mobile assets, that is Hutchinson. We had Hutch company. So that Hutchinson company or Wompo, Hutchinson Wompo company was, I mean, it has taken over the Hutchinson mobile assets by a deal, or it has purchased by a deal of 11 billion US dollars. And that was the initial situation wherein the issue between the government of India and the Vodafone has started. And the government said that the Vodafone is liable to pay taxes of the acquisition. Acquisition what means what? It has gone ahead with merger. That means Vodafone has acquired. It has purchased. Vodafone has purchased Hutchinson. So in the process of acquisition, so what the government of India says is Vodafone is liable. It is bound to pay taxes, and those taxes the company did not pay. Which company? Vodafone. Thereby the government of India has imposed the tax plus, that is interest, tax on interest plus penalties. So this was altogether 2 billion US dollars. Now you got the entire issue. So this is in regards to the case wherein it has actually originated between Vodafone and government of India, when Vodafone has purchased an Indian mobile assets, that is the company Hutchinson. So when they have acquired it, when they have purchased it, in the process Vodafone was supposed to pay the taxes which it has acquired, and that taxes, interest and penalties is not been paid by Vodafone, and the government has said that Vodafone has to pay 2 billion. And that case, now the Vodafone has won over Government of India. And later on, in 2012, after 2007, now again in 2012, India Stop Court, that is Supreme Court of India, has ruled in favor of telecom provider. Look at it. The Government of India said that you to Vodafone that it has to pay back to the Government of India $2 billion. But when the Vodafone has approached the top Supreme Court, that is Top Court of India, the Apex Court of India, that is Supreme Court of India, in the year 2012, Supreme Court of India has ruled in favor of telecom provider, that is Vodafone. But the government changed the rules to enable it, the tax deals, so that it already had been concluded. So when the Supreme Court has favored, given a judgment or a verdict in favor of telecom providers, the government of India has changed the rules pertaining to tax deals. And later on again in the year 2014, Vodafone has initiated an arbitration against India in the International Arbitration Tribunal. International Arbitration Tribunal, it has initiated in the year 2014. And now in the year 2020, after 6 years, Vodafone has won the case against Government of India. And this ruling brings an end to one of the most controversial dispute in India under international treaty agreement. So that is what even the tribunal has said, that India has breached the international treaty agreements between India and Netherlands. That is what, in regards to the entering into the countries which would protect the foreign investors. So when you are, when Government of India is wanting the FDIs or the foreign investors to come and invest in India, it is the need of the government to also protect the foreign investors, to create a confidence that yes, they can do business in India. But rather now, if you look at, because of the tax, because of the tax liabilities, the foreign investors may not have the thinking capacity, or they should, they would definitely get into the mode of pulling away or not coming and investing in India. Okay. Before I get into the next topic, Sunil Reddy has joined, Azmat Khan has joined. A warm welcome to you, both of you. Welcome to AKSIS Academy Daily News Analysis. And Pratham Chavan says, is decentralization in terms of taxes, policy decisions to be a solution for such disputes in public-private domain? See, that initially it has to be discussed, or it has to be resolved, not discussed. That is in regards to the dispute resolution mechanism. Dispute resolution mechanism, it has to be discussed, or it has to have or find a solution within the, within the country, any country, and or versus the foreign investor. But if it is not resolved, then it goes back to the international, any of the party can go and approach the international arbitration, in our International Court of Justice also. Decentralization in terms of taxes, policy decisions to be a solution for disputes in public-private. In regards to decentralization of terms of taxes and policies decision, but ultimately, Pratham, it is important in regards to the dispute resolution. Even though you have the taxes which are decentralized in terms of taxes and policy decision, but ultimately, again, the Government of India is now interfering in regards to the case Vodafone, that they have to pay back the tax liability claims. So it what is important is the dispute resolution mechanism has to be in favor of trying to have a balance in favor of both the foreign investors, and also it should help the Government of India also. And Yugendra is also joined, a warm welcome. Pandangia has also joined, a warm welcome to AKSIS Academy. And the another news is, a soothing voice falls silent. So this is a disturbing news which we are forced to listen to, this wherein the legendary playback singer S.P. Balasubramaniam, or generally called as S.P.B. or famously called as S.P.B., has passed away in Chennai at the age of 74. And he was hospitalized in the month of August because being tested positive for COVID-19. And on September 7th, he was tested negative. And then there was a gradual progress that he was moving from positive to negative. But still, he was continuing on the ventilators and ECMO. And he was also going ahead with some passive physiotherapy. But later on, his situation has deteriorated and he suffered a cardiorespiratory arrest. And because of the cardiorespiratory attack, he has died. I mean, his death, no doubt it is in regards to the testing positive of COVID-19. But later on, when the situation has worsened or deteriorated, he suffered because of the cardiorespiratory. There are two here, heart and lungs. Please do understand. Cardio, and that is almost multiple organ has impacted. Cardio and respiratory. And here we have seen he was continued on ventilator and ECMO. So we will focus at ECMO, taking this as a keyword for the preliminary examination. So what does ECMO means? ECMO means, it stands for extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. So this is a machine which is almost similar to heart lung bypass machine. It is almost, yes, Pratham, very good. Comorbidity, more than comorbidity, it is not really comorbidity, we will look at it. Heart lung bypass machine used in open heart surgery. So ECMO, again this abbreviation is important for preliminary examination, especially it could be in regards to the state public service commissions or even in UPSC, it could be part of it. That when ECMO, what is the ECMO stands for, which among the following statements, or which among the following statements are incorrect in regards to ECMO, which has been used by the health or doctors for a patient or COVID-19 patient. So it is extracorporeal membrane oxygen, which is a machine which is used in the heart lung bypass machine, wherein an patient goes ahead with open heart surgery. What does this machine do? It pumps and oxygenates a patient's blood outside the body. Please do understand. This machine is used to pump and oxygenate the patient's blood outside the body, allowing the heart and lungs to rest. That means the heart and lungs are not in a position to function the way it functions, so that the pumping of the blood and then the deoxygenated blood which gets from heart to the lungs, and lungs again oxygenate the blood, I mean it purifies the blood, and then the oxygenated blood again is passed to the heart. Heart again passes the oxygenated blood to the entire parts of the body. So here the functioning of heart and lungs, when it had deteriorated, so ECMO machine comes into play. So that is about ECMO. And Pratham says, can a separate statutory body like SEBI help in such dispute resolution? In regards to the SEBI, it is in regards to the share market. SEBI, it is only regards to share market. It doesn't fall under in regards to dispute resolution. You have a separate dispute resolution mechanism, which even the bills have been passed by the monsoon session, in the monsoon session. In regards to comorbidity, it was not comorbidity because later on he has developed the cardiorespiratory arrest. Comorbidity is earlier itself, you have the ailment of, it could be sugar, I mean diabetic, or it could be in regards to the kidney problem, dialysis. So in that cases it would be a comorbidity, but here later on he has as the situation or the condition deteriorated, then he has suffered cardiorespiratory. And his full name is Sripati Pandita Aradhyula Balasubramanyam. Pandita or Sripati Pandita Aradhyula Balasubramanyam. He was born in 1946 to a Harikatha exponent. That is, his father name is Sambamurthy. And initially, Balasubramanyam had an ambition to become an engineer, but he has landed up to become a legendary singer. And he has started singing, or his debut in the sense initial starting in the year 1966 in a Telugu movie called as Sri 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 Mariyada Ramanna. So why I am taking this is, could be that it could be asked in State Public Service Commission in the competitive exams, which among the following is the first movie of the legendary singer Balasubramanyam, who has passed away recently because of the COVID-19. It is Sri 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 Mariyada Ramanna, and he has sung over 40,000 songs in 16 languages, and he has been in this singing songs for 5 decades, and he has been the voice of generation of various actors. And we went on to win, he had won 6 national awards. He was awarded Padmashri Award in 2001, and then Padma Bhushan Award in 2011. And he is survived by a wife, son and daughter, that is Charan and Pallavi. Both the son and daughter are also singers. Here what is that I and you all can learn is that he has been in singing for 5 decades. So nowadays, to be a successful even for 5 years is definitely a daunting task. It would be very tough to handle your competitors or the next generation who are more skilled and equipped than us. But he has been in the singing as a legendary for 5 decades. So this is what we can learn from him. And he has been the voice of generation of the actors. So, this is President Neelam Sanjeev Reddy presenting the National Award for the Best Playback Male Playback Singer in the year 1981 to Balasubramanyam for the movie or the song movie which he has sung in the movie Ek Dooje Ke Liye, April 27, 1982, he has received the award. So, we did lose a legendary singer. And the another news is, yes, Pratham says determination and consistency, absolutely. And the other news is MCI replaced by NMC. What is MCI? That is Medical Council of India is now called as, or it is replaced by National Medical Commission. And this National Medical Commission has been replaced by, or has replaced the Medical Council of India, or Medical Council of India, it is also Board of Governors, Medical Council of India. And this is as per the information which has been released by the Health Ministry on September 25th, 2020. And this changes or replacement of MCI by NMC is aiming that there would be reforms in the medical education. That because they wanted reforms in the medical education, now the Medical Council of India has been replaced by the National Medical Commission. And the government has dissolved this in 2018. That is, MCI was dissolved in the year 2018 itself. Please do understand. Here I am saying MCI is replaced by NMC. Today's news. But if you look at the intricacy of it, That is, MCI was replaced in the year 2018 itself with Board of Governors. That is why here we have Board of Governors of MCI, not only MCI. So initially MCI, it was later on replaced with Board of Governors of Medical Council of India, which was chaired by V.K. Paul, then the Niti Aayog, member of the Niti Aayog, and Board of Governor has been appointed under Section 3A of the Indian Medical Council Act 1946. So this act is the important or the keyword, because which among the following act or like the Board of Governors in the Medical Council of India were appointed under which among the following acts, which among the following sections and acts, that is Section 3A of Indian Medical Council Act 1956, and this has now been dissolved with a gazette notification by the Union Ministry of Health and Family Affairs. It is Health Ministry, but in toto it is Health and Family Welfare, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And this Indian Medical Council Act, Indian Medical Council Act 1956 has been repealed by with an act on September 25th 2020. This is what it is in regards to the, you have health reforms bills, you have three health reforms bills which have been passed in the monsoon session 2020, that is on September 25th. One is in regards to the medicine, the another bill is in regards to the Ayurveda, and the third one is in regards to the homeopathy. So three bills have been passed and which are part of the health reform bills. One is medicine. So this MCI being replaced by NMC is part of the medicine bill 2020, which has been passed in both the houses. Along with that, you have Ayurveda bill and homeopathy bill. So please do understand, the bills which have been passed in the house in the monsoon session. Okay, Pratham says that, are these reforms a result of lack of transparency and inefficiency? If you look at, I have said that this is in regards to the reforms in medical education, so that they wanted to make sure that they have a kind of a well-researched body, and also making sure that any kind of issues they can be dealt, so there can be any dispute resolution mechanism also placed in it, so that when there are any kind of issues between the Board of Governors, it can be resolved. Now yes, definitely transparency and inefficiency in regards to the education and research. And you have another news which talks about Quad discusses Indo-Pacific infrastructure and 5G. So here the keyword is infrastructure, and 5G was discussed by the Quad, that is quadrilateral. So four countries which are part of the Quad group are India, US, Australia and Japan, have met virtually on the sidelines of United Nations General Assembly, and they had the periodic consultation which is in regards to the Indo-Pacific region. So Indo-Pacific region is strategically very important, strategically or geostrategically it is important for US, Australia, Japan and India, as well as China. So the Ministry of External Affairs, when it has discussed, or the officials of the foreign ministers have met and then discussed about the periodic consultation of the Indo-Pacific region. So Ministry of External Affairs from India have discussed the ongoing and proposed practical cooperation in the areas of connectivity and infrastructure development in Indo-Pacific region. So it is in regards to the connectivity and infrastructure. So when we are talking about connectivity, it is about the 5G, and then infrastructure, yes, development. of the connectivity, again infrastructural. So thereby, again in regards to that, US has spelled out, or it has come up with, it's repealed in the sense removed. Kalyan Chakravarti, repealed means removed or cancelled. Or cancelled. US State Department has also put forward its view that there should be a discussion on the connectivity, because definitely the importance of digital connectivity, this is important, this keyword, digital connectivity, which is being discussed along the Quad group members, that digital connectivity and secure networks. This is another keyword. Digital connectivity and secure network is the keywords which have been discussed along the Quad, and US is definitely highlighting the importance of digital connectivity and secure network. Why? So that it can promote the trusted vendors in regards to what? The fifth generation network, in regards to the 5G network. The US is saying that we need to promote the trusted vendors. So when we are focusing on these trusted vendors, US is definitely, it is pointing fingers at China, that China is not a trusted vendor in regards to the 5G. The company is Huawei. Huawei company. Generally you pronounce it as Huawei or Huawei. That is not Huawei, it is Huawei. Huawei. Ravi Kumar says, sir, I want this session PDF. Okay. Fine. We'll look into it, whether it is possible by the AKS IAS Academy. Pratham says, infrastructure means more focus on port development. Absolutely. When we are talking about Indo-Pacific region, it is in regards to the port development. That is why recently we have seen in regards to Andaman Nicobar Islands connectivity of Andaman Nicobar Islands from Chennai to Port Blair. Recently we have seen that, to Port Blair. So here it is in regards to the digital connectivity, as well as making sure that we develop the entire almost 12 islands in the Andaman Nicobar Islands, so that we will be improving the port infrastructure, so that it will help in economy. It will help in economy. Okay. Quad equal to NATO. The time Quad equal to NATO, the time will decide. Pratham, and this is an effort to stop, definitely it is effort to stop the G5 network giant Huawei from entering into various countries, coming up with its outlets in various other countries. So US is definitely sending a message that we need to have or promote a vendor who is really able to have confidence. And other topics which were discussed by the Quad officials are counter-terrorism, cyber and maritime security, and quality infrastructure of the Indo-Pacific region. So Indo-Pacific region is important. Now what we discuss in regards to the international relations, again in regards to the dynamic part, international relations in regards to the dynamic part. And then again, not only in regards to the Indo-Pacific region, but there was discussion in regards to the ASEAN also. Both, so India and US are committed to support the concept of ASEAN centrality. Concept of ASEAN centrality. So this is another keyword which could be a probable keyword in the questions in the mains examination, on the concept of ASEAN centrality in the Indo-Pacific and ASEAN's leadership in the architecture of the region. The role of India in the concept of ASEAN centrality in the Indo-Pacific and ASEAN's leadership in the architecture of region. No doubt, India is not part of ASEAN. India is definitely a member of SAARC. But what could be the role of India trying to get into the mode of supporting the concept? The role of India in supporting the concept, of ASEAN centrality in the Indo-Pacific and ASEAN's leadership in the architecture of the region. Discuss. Mains. IR. GS paper 2. In the mains examination. So this is how you need to keep on focusing. That how we can analyze and then link it with prelims or mains examinations. And US is also exploring ways to work together even in the Mekong sub-region. So where is Mekong? It is in the part of the South China Sea wherein it is China, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia. It passes through China, Laos, Vietnam, Cambodia. That region also US is trying to explore ways to work together in the Mekong sub-region and also in the Indo-Pacific. Why it wanted to work together and it is exploring ways so that it will support international laws, pluralism, regional stability and post-pandemic recovery efforts. Please do understand, US is exploring ways to work together in the Mekong sub-region and also in the Indo-Pacific to support what? The international law, pluralism, regional stability and post-pandemic recovery efforts. So, look at the way the US is definitely trying to have its presence in the South China Sea. Please you understand, in the South China Sea and in the Indo-Pacific region. And US is also making a statement that it describes collective efforts for what? To a free, open and inclusive Indo-Pacific region. Please do understand, there would be at least one question in the mains of UPSC 2020 on the Indo-Pacific region. Or region of Indian Ocean. There would be it. So thereby you can try to add all these short notes in part of your answer. And the government of India, that is the Ministry of External Affairs, has also reiterated that it has, made it very clear that it is ready to work with the ASEAN and all the countries towards realizing a common and promising vision for Indo-Pacific. So look at it. Look at this. You focus on this point and focus on this point. What I said, the question. India's role in or to support the concept of ASEAN centrality in the Indo-Pacific and ASEAN's leadership in the architecture region. And then link it with this. The Ministry of External Affairs has says that official reiterated their readiness to work with the ASEAN and all other countries in what? In realizing a common and promising vision for Indo-Pacific. So definitely there can be a question in the mains in regards to the Indo-Pacific region. Please do focus this in regards to the mains. And Shiva has also joined. A warm welcome to you, Shiva, to AKS IAS Academy Daily News Analysis. And Pratham says, can these developments in Quad and ASEAN help in building new global supply lines? That is what US is trying. That is what even Australia wanted. And at the same time, when Quad was actually being taken up in the initial years of Quad, India was really reluctant that how best it would be in the interest of India to be part or to have a major role in the Quad. But now, as China is definitely posing a threat to India, now India is definitely getting into the mode of having the more active role in the Quad and also accepting Australia to be part of the, Australia is part of Quad, Australia to be part of the mission in regards to the Malabar exercise, So definitely it is a global supply lines and also in regards to the security. Kalyan Chakravarti, I'll check whether it is possible. Otherwise, you can just consult the AKSIS Academy. You can consult the or you can get into the website, Kalyan, and then probably you can get there. And there is another news which talks about IRDA lists LIC, GIC, New India as what? Systematically important. So what is this systematically important? We will focus. So what is IRDA? IRDA is Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India. It is a regulatory body and a development authority. That is insurance regulatory. It is a insurance regulatory and a development authority of India. That is what you call it as IRDA. And this IRDA has identified three, that is the Life Insurance Corporation of India, General Insurance Corporation of India and the New India Assurance as what? As, this is a keyword, domestic systematically important insurance, domestic systematically important insurance for 2020-21. So this is a crucial information for preliminary examination, for preliminary UPSC perspective. And this is important as they have identified this, or it has listed, IRDA has listed the three as the DSIIs. So definitely the all the three have to have a nature of operations and the systemic importance should definitely be given the nature of the operation and the system of importance. And the regulator, that is IRDA, has asked the three public sector insurance to raise the level of corporate governance. So definitely the three, which are the public sector insurers, have to raise or to improve the corporate governance. The first one, they should identify all the relevant risks, if at all there are there. And then the three have to promote a sound and risk management culture. So these are all the three keywords. All the keywords. That is, corporate governance is a keyword. And then identifying the relevant risks. And then promote a sound risk management culture. So these are the keywords. When you can try to get into the mode of identifying the keywords, then it will be very easy for you to eliminate a statement in the preliminary examination when a question is framed on the domestic systematically important insurance, insurers. So this would be the keyword for the preliminary examination, and DSIIs will all be subjected to enhanced regulatory supervision. So they will increase the regulatory supervision, which is as per the IRDAI. So please do understand the importance of IRDAI, because this IRDAI is in news for almost 3 days. This news, IRDAI, is in news for 3 days. So do try to understand the importance of the regulatory and development authority of India, that is in regards to the insurance. And definitely this DSIIR, the insurance which are of size, which have market importance, which have a big size, market importance, domestic and global connectiveness is definitely there, and definitely their distress or failure, if at all there is any distress in the three public sector insurers, and if there are any failures in the public sector insurers, the three LIC, GIC and New India Insurance, so definitely it would cause a significant dislocation in what? In the domestic financial system. This is a keyword. So if at all there is any kind of risk or any kind of failure in the management system in the three insurers, so it will cause a significant dislocation of the domestic financial system in India itself, and thereby the continued functioning of the three public sector insurers is critical, and there should be for uninterrupted of insurance services which will add positive to the national economy. So look at it, what IRDAI has come up with, the DSIIs are linked to the national economy. Are you getting the point? They are linked to the national economy. Why? Because they are the one who are actually having a very good size in India, and they have the market importance, and they have the domestic and global interconnectedness. That is why it will add value to the national economy. And definitely these three DSIIs are too big and too important to fail. So that means it should not fail. It should not fail. That is what the statement is. It means that they are big and they are important, and we cannot afford the three insurers to fail or to get into the mode of an unsuccessful insurer, so that it will impact the domestic financial system. And these DSIIs are subjected to additional regulatory measures so that it can deal with any kind of systemic risk and any moral hazard issues which are or which would be in the process, which would arise in the process, so that now the DSIIs will have the additional regulatory measures. So definitely IRDAI and then DSIIs are very critical and crucial information for the UPSC prelims perspective point of view. So definitely here now we will recapitulate what we have discussed. So this is in regards to the arbitration or International Arbitration Tribunal, which has given a judgment, and this now will impact the foreign investors to invest in India in a negative way. And this is, we have looked at the legendary singer S.P. Balasubramanian, and this could be again from current affairs point of view. And here again, this is part of the health reform bills which have been passed in the monsoon session. So we have looked at medical bill, homeopathy bill and Ayurveda bill were passed. So focus on the three health related bills. Please do understand, focus on the health related or health reforms bill, so that it could be very crucial for preliminary point of view. And Quad discusses Indo-Pacific infrastructure and 5G. This is in regards to the international relations. Again, in regards to the dynamic part of it, that is dynamic current affairs. And then here when we are focusing on, we should focus on ASEAN and Indo-Pacific region. ASEAN and Indo-Pacific region, the importance, strategic importance of Indo-Pacific region, and now ASEAN is also important for developing of ASEAN, important for US. And also we have looked at Mekong River subway or sub-region. And IRDA, again this is in regards to the economy for preliminary examination. focusing on prelims perspective. So we are focused on various issues which are certainly useful, informative and knowledgeable to you all, and certainly with great determination I would say that you all, the one who are associated with AKS, IAS Academy daily news analysis and who are following my daily news analysis, that is Sandeep Bhushan Thummala, will be having an edge over others in regards to the prelims as well as mains examination from UPSC perspective. So I would say a very big thank you and good luck to you all. And then before you sign off, do not forget to like, share and subscribe the AKS IAS channel, and then do visit the website and then subscribe the Telegram link of AKS IAS Academy, and then see you again on Monday 7:30 a.m. Do follow the consistency, stick to your schedule, and also do take care of your physical health and mental health. Thank you very much, and then see you on Monday.